Following program contains explicit language and subject matter and is intended for mature audiences only. Listener discretion is advised.
You know the two of us. We are the closest living out here. Jenny and me putting ice cream on each other's noses and feeding the deer. Jenny and me. We were going to build a normal life here, a carefree existence of laughter and play. But General Kirby, he led them right to us, and then the bastards took her away. Jenny and me. John, it's your old friend
Bennett. I thought you were
dead. Not true, John. If you want your daughter, you'd better play along.
Fuck you,
John. An assassination.
I will not do this.
You pull it off, she'll be just fine.
Don't put me through
this. If you fail, we will mail her to you.
No deal.
You will get her back one piece at a time,
Jenny. Look, you have to help. They took my Jenny. You give me a lift and we follow the trail.
Jenny,
we will fend off all the mall policemen. We let Sully go and cook, we impale.
Jenny and me.
We stop to do some last minute shopping. So many good ones, not easy to choose. We borrow this plane and we fly to the island. Or fucking hell is about to break loose. Jenny and me. Jenny and me. Jenny and me. John, it's your old friend Bennett.
Let's party.
I told you I'd be ready for you.
We'll see, Bennett.
You know I'm feeling good, John. Just like old times, Matrix and
Bennett
me.
And me.
And when you're laying dead before
bullshit.
Me, Paul has finally fulfilled my dream.
Bennett.
I'm gonna shoot you between the balls.
So do
I'm
it.
I'm gonna kill you.
Bennett, let off some steam.
You know the two of us. We're going home now. Back to the mountains for Jenny and me. Wipe those tears away, cause daddy's here now. Everyone's dead, you're finally free.
We want you to start up your unit again, John.
No chance. And do you see this woman standing here? She's going to be your new mother. We're going home now, Jenny and me, Jenny and me.
It's alive! Oh, it's not open yet. Whoops. I got a tall boy. I was about ready to just take a big old hit off it. Well, that didn't work out. You're listening to Portland Sucks broadcast live each and every weekday at 9 a.m. Pacific time, standard or daylight. It's all the same to us. Provided, of course, that we adjust our clocks accordingly. This is episode number... Oh, hell. 69. Episode number 69 for Monday, October 17th in the year 2011, one day before my birthday. To my left, Sabrina Miller. Good morning, Sabrina Miller.
Good morning.
So we almost didn't do a show today.
Yeah.
We didn't do a show on Friday because I've been ill.
Yeah, you have.
Yeah. I mean, I haven't been able to talk or do much of anything worthwhile or useful. I managed to have my voice back for maybe, what was it like? 3 or 4 hours on Friday evening. But the rest of the time, been running a fever. lots of coughing and hacking and, you know, nose stuffed up and all that kind of crap. But
that really sucks. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it is all your fault.
Of course it is.
The nice part, though, is I was able to drug myself out of oblivion long enough to be fanciful last Friday night.
Nah.
Which was a pleasant endeavor, I should say. But in the meantime, before we get to that, we'd like to remind you, of course, that it is an interactive program, which means that, I don't know, you can chat in the chat box if you're listening live. If not, if you're listening to this as a podcast, later on the day, the hour, the week, the month, the year, send an email, podcast@pdxsucks.com, and we promise one of these days we'll eventually get to those.
Yeah, sometime we will.
Yeah. Lots of good mornings. Four Cookies in the chat box says, good morning, Robert and Sabrina.
Good morning, Four Cookies.
Yeah. Well, Tony in the chat box says, what's crackin', playa? You be illin'. Thank you, sir.
Wow.
Okay.
Cracker.
Well, you got it. Well, not. No, what's crackin', playa?
Oh, what's crackin'? Okay, no. Well, sorry. You're a playa instead of a cracker.
I'm a cracker.
Yeah, you are.
It's okay. I don't care.
Okay.
That's fine. Yeah, so we have a big housekeeping tomorrow.
Oh, housekeeping.
But that's tomorrow.
Aww.
Yeah, that's tomorrow.
Okay.
A lot of responses and things like that, too. I don't know, whatever the last episode was. I think it was Thursday or something like that.
Yeah.
Good times, though. Good times were had by all. But in the meantime, this is just in. And this is very important because it's going to, well, not at all tie into something that we're going to talk about today. But nonetheless, I feel that this needs to come first. Vivid Video, the adult video corporation conglomerate, Supercorp. You're probably not familiar with what I'm talking about, but nonetheless, Vivid Video. I do believe the single largest producer of adult films in the nation is seeking to cash in on the Occupy Wall Street craze.
How are they going to do that?
Well, if you shut up and let me tell you, I'll tell you. Vivid President Steve Hirsch says that their latest series, tentatively titled Occupy Pussy, will, quote, bring in some much-needed sexcapades to what is a serious, serious topic in our nation today.
Wow.
No word on who will be starring in the films or whether or not the action will take place in a tent. But there you have it.
Wow.
And see, to me, the name, I'm glad it's tentative because it lacks imagination.
You know, it really does.
It does. Occupy Pussy. Like, come on. That's as good as Occupy Wall Street. There's got to Occupy Ball Street. You know, come on. Anything would have been better.
Yeah, exactly. You see a whole bunch of people like rolling around in the hay that they put down in order to like absorb some of the smell, but it just doesn't seem very creative in my mind.
Yeah, Pontoni comes in with Occupy Ball Street. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, you go.
There you go. See, great minds. I don't know. Have nothing better to do at 9 o'clock in the morning.
Playa.
Shut up. Really?
Hey, I didn't say it. Somebody else did, so, you know.
That doesn't mean you have to repeat them. You were that annoying kid, weren't you?
What do you mean?
You were that annoying kid, weren't you?
What?
What?
Oh, God, really?
Oh, God, really?
Stop it.
Stop it. But, yeah, I mean, would you rush right? See, I don't, in order for it to be accurate whatsoever, you know, for real life, my God, just think of the filth that's involved.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I actually went down Saturday. I took a break, worked all goddamned weekend, while sick, mind you, and managed to head down, get some lunch, and stopped by, Pioneer Courthouse Square, where they were all gathered there for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And a gentleman that looked something like sort of a svelter, thinner Fred Durst was up at the top of, you know, the over part. You know what I mean? The part that looks down on the square itself.
Ah, yes.
I don't know what you call it. I'm sick, man. So cut me some slack. But he was up there, and he's just like, yeah. And then the whole crowd would go, yeah. You know, and he's just, you know, he'd put his arms up like he's fucking Rocky every time. And he'd grab this bullhorn, and I thought, my God, this is terrible.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it really is. I mean, here's this guy wearing a wife beater and, like, you know, his low slung jeans. And, you know, it just he didn't seem like a leader to me. That's all.
Yeah.
But, you know, he was protesting. He's, you know, we are the 99%. And everybody goes, we are the 99%. We're not going to take it. And everybody else would say, we're not going to take it. We are the 99%. We are the 99%. It was just, who are we? The 99%. I'm thinking, God, you know, you got to, and I tweeted this out at the time, you got to get the capitalists from the Timbers Army down there to show this douche how to do it right. You know what I mean?
Hell yeah.
There's nothing interesting about this. Now, I don't know if everybody in the whole audience, whatever you want to call it, the group, as it were, is too stoned to actually follow along with anything longer than about 7 syllables. But there it is. You know, it just, it was really kind of, okay, this is lame.
Yeah. Yeah, they really do need somebody to lead a little bit more effectively, or at least put some rhythm of some kind into the chants. I don't know, maybe, you know, clap your hands or...
I mean, yeah, a little bit of production or...
Something.
Yeah, some I don't know, it's a melody maybe.
You know, maybe everybody would be much better protesters if they could all just get in line and do, like, the boot scootin' boogie or something, or the, what is it, the electric boogaloo or whatever.
Please, don't ever say those things on here. Don't ever say those things. You're talking about boot scoot boogie?
Yeah, no, like the electric thingy or whatever.
No, God, the electric slide?
Yeah, that's what it is. No. Thank you. Yeah, I mean, just something to be
God,
a little
I
bit
hate
more creative.
You today.
Why?
I hate you today. Why would you bring that up?
Because.
Look, you bumpkin. I don't want to hear about any of that stuff.
Of course.
You take your Wisconsin ass and go back to Wyoming.
Well, fine. I shall do so right now.
Leaving me here to fend for myself. Exactly. That would be no fun. Anyway, though, I left the square and I actually had a more enjoyable time sort of on the outskirts of the whole thing. I eventually went to go get my lunch at one of the food car pods down on God knows where and whatever the cross street is. There's like two huge pods down there. I can't remember. It's like 10th and something. I don't know. But the interesting thing for me was I actually ran across some suburbanites. I was at a crosswalk with some suburbanites heading over there, and they were just ecstatic about going over to, you know, see the food carts and things like that. Now, why wouldn't they? You know, when you're used to Applebee's and the Red Robin as, you know, culinary delights, then, yeah, some of the stuff is going to be, oh, my God, you know, my taste buds have just erupted in orgasmic pleasure.
Okay.
But as we were standing there, one of the Occupy folks jaywalked right in front of traffic. I mean, and approached us and said, "Hey, yo, can I just give $5?
$5?
$5. And I thought, wow, you know, no longer do you want change. You actually want a full $5, like a $5 bill, five ones. I don't know, four ones, four quarters. I'm not sure what denomination he would have preferred.
Paper currency.
Yeah, $5. Do you have $5? And one of the two women that was standing there, it was like a woman and I think probably her older teen daughter, but it's... They get enough work done out in the burbs sometimes. Sometimes it's really hard to tell. You know what I mean? But they were obviously sort of taken aback by it. And the woman goes, I don't have $5. And the guy goes, man, if I could just get $5, I could get a plate of pad thai. You know, $5 over here, I get a plate of pad thai. Me and my friends can share it. You know? Yo.
Wow.
And they were just, wow, you know, I'm really sorry. They gave him the full lowdown, you know, the whole, I'm really sorry, I can't help you today, you know, and all this. They were extremely respectful, extremely polite, because, you know, the 99% is obviously very hungry.
Oh, of course.
But yeah, I just thought that was pretty cool. It's like all of a sudden it's jumped from, can you spare some change to, can you spare a dollar? Can I have $5 so I can get some pad thai? I mean, how specific is that?
Oh, well, I think it's going to be, you know, like, give me $5. I don't even think, I saw actually a couple tweets today, this morning, in fact, and a couple over the weekend that people were asking, they weren't even asking for change, or they'd say, give me your change. They weren't even asking for it anymore. They're like demanding it.
Well, see, at that point, it's robbery.
Oh, of course it is.
I mean, it really is. And that's why, you know, you should just carry something, a heavy object around with you, just so that when that happens, you can, I don't know, go, eek, and, you know, pummel them in the face with it or something.
Well, you know, to the people coming in from the burbs, I mean, to their credit, a lot of the women, they have, like, you know, purses that kind of weigh a lot. So, I mean, that's our weapon.
Well,
right,
and they all carry those ill-advised canisters of mace, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
They like to give each other in case they have to go downtown.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? But, you know, he just... I don't know. It was strange because all I could think of was Sally Struthers. For just $5, me and my friends can eat from a plate of pad thai. Wouldn't you like to support us? No, go to hell. No. No. And, you know, what's fucked up is he was kind of following the whole group for a while. And my first thought, fucking A, I'm going to stop at this pad thai place and get myself a big old plate of pad thai for $5. Now that I know the price, I'm going to sit here and fucking eat it.
Oh, yeah, right in his face.
Right,
yeah,
in front of you.
Well.
Yeah.
Yeah, right in front of you so that the smell wafts into his nose.
No, I just figured, you know, hell, dude, what I'm going to do, I'm going to do you a favor. I'm going to do you a solid, boy. What I'm going to do, I'm not going to chew it very good. So, you know, when I take a dump later, you can give me $2 and pick through it. How about that? You fuck. No, fuck that guy, man. Just for $5, I get a plate of pad thai. How about you give me whatever you have? I'll let you live, punk.
Yeah,
how about
no
that,
kidding.
Boy?
Wow.
Yeah, once you head back to fucking Nantucket, shut the fuck up.
Damn, dude.
No, I get real tired of it, man. I get real tired of it.
You know, I honestly, I do too. But, I mean, very specifically, yes, I would... probably be thrown a little off guard with the $5 for pad thai. I mean, that's just kind of a really odd request. I've heard of the, you know, I need some change or a couple dollars to, you know, give me some methadone. I've heard.
And I'm not going to give you money for methadone, punk. I'm going to give you what I have in my pocket. How about that? Because I always carry a little extra something, something. Because, you know, I see the hurt. I see the hurt in everyone's eyes. I want to help. I'm here to help.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it's all about.
Well, see, a lot of the people that are asking for change or, you know, money of any kind, especially downtown in the Pioneer
area.
Yeah,
see, you have to specify that they're asking for money now, because if you simply say all these people that are asking for change, they're just Democrats. You see what I mean? They're just Democrats at this point. If you're asking for change, you're a Democrat. If you're asking for money, well, then you're actually, you know, probably in need in some capacity.
Of some currency of some kind, exactly.
Because, yeah, you know, Obama wanted change. And, you know, it hasn't really happened yet, but nonetheless, there's that.
Are you
that.
Kidding me? He got enough change. Are you kidding me? He got change in the wrong direction.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
No, oh, it's just a Sabrina Miller political hour.
That is my political hour. I am done. No, I'm saying that the people that are asking for money of any kind in Pioneer Square, I don't know if I'm just like spending too much time around the area, but I know who they are as far as what they're going to ask for ahead of time.
I know who you are.
So
what do you mean?
Will cross the street. Like, I recognize them because they've asked me so many damn times.
Oh,
and it's
right.
Just like, you need to get a new line or cut your hair, or like, I will give you a pair of scissors or something to like
cut your hair.
Do something.
Why?
Different.
Why? What does
to
that
you.
Matter?
I'm just saying.
I don't cut my hair.
I don't know. It doesn't matter if you don't cut your hair, but at least you would come up with like new and creative ways to ask people for the same thing.
See, it's all in how you dress.
Well, okay.
It
then.
Is. It's all in how you dress. And see, I don't get approached by people like this guy. I mean, nobody's going to come up to me and go, hey, you got $5. They'll ask me for a cigarette. They'll ask me for, you know, a quarter, something like that. But no motherfucker like, you know, downtown is going to come up to me, you know, dressed as I would, you know, day by day, by day, by day, is going to come up and say, can I have $5 for just a simple $5? Me and my friends can get a full plate of pad thai. Well, now, wait a minute. If you want to add chicken to that, that makes it $6.
Right.
You know, you don't want chicken. What are you, vegan? Fuck you, vegan. I'm not giving you $5. Get the fuck out of here.
We're going to give the chicken to the dog, man. God, come down.
Yeah, of course you are. Yes, because my little Fido should definitely suffer because your punk ass can't get a goddamn job.
Exactly.
Anyway, moving on, though. I did notice that Friday night, I went to the ballet. Mm-hmm. I went to the ballet, and what I noticed was is that, you know, because when you go to the ballet, unfortunately, well, I'm sort of a cliche. I actually dress for the ballet and, you know, did it up a little bit, you know, clean myself up. I clean up okay.
Nice.
I'm fine. But, you know, I went and I did that. And to and from the ballet, I was hit up for all kinds of things. All of a sudden, it's not, hey, do you have a cigarette? It's, you know, hey, do you have $3? You know, it's these various, nobody asked me for, you know, what they needed the $3 for. Nobody said, you know, hey, do you have $3 so that I can go get, I don't know, a Slurpee and two Big Bites.
Uh-huh.
You know, nobody asked that. You know, it was no $5, you know, pad thai plate. But the ante was up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've heard a lot of people, especially now that the TriMet in Portland here has raised their prices again, that, you know, hey, man, do you have like $2.10? And at that point, it's so kind of like, okay, well, that's a very specific
number. I got to get to Eugene.
You need a bus ticket. Okay.
I got to get to Occupy Eugene. And somewhere Eugene's ass is like really sore. He's like, ah, get out.
But the fact it would cost you way more than $2.10 to get to Eugene.
I have no idea what it costs. I've actually been hit up for bus fare to Eugene before.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes, it was a student.
Oh.
That needed money to get to Eugene.
That's a little sad, actually.
No, it's really not. Because what you do is you go, dude, no. And then you just walk away. You know, there's no reason at this point in time, the way the world works, to take pity on people like that. Mm-hmm. You know, because I don't believe you. You know, you walk up to me with a tank top, baggy jeans, and a fucking needle hanging out of your arm, and you go, I need $2 to get to Eugene. You know, I don't believe you at that point. You know what I mean?
Totally.
You know, I think you're just doing your best Patrick Swayze impersonation.
Oh, ouch. Ouch, that hurts.
Yeah.
Wow.
So anyway, long story short, I didn't end up getting the pad thai, but I watched this guy just harass the crap out of a whole bunch of fine, upstanding Portland area citizens.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Douche.
From there, though, I had, you know, I took a walk. I needed a break. You know, I needed a break. So I ended up eating, and then I proceeded to head north, and I ended up getting a little thirsty, working up a thirst. Remember when they used to call it that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the old people call it that. And I ended up at the Burnside Fred Meyer.
Okay.
Burnside Fred Meyer? Yeah. And, you know, I'm walking through there, and, I stopped to the cold beverage aisle, and I decided, you know, I'm just going to take a walk around, see if there's anything appealing, you know, anything I might need, and then realize now I'd have to walk all the way back with it. But I see this gentleman walk up to one of the employees there, and he's, like, very tall guy, about 6'6", 6'7", something like that. Real dopey-looking guy. And he walks up to this guy, and he goes, yeah, I need some help with some lotions. I'm thinking, okay, well, here's a conversation that I need at this point to eavesdrop on this conversation. Because, who says that? I need some help with some lotions. And the guy goes, okay, well, what can I... Well, I got this rash between my legs.
Oh, no.
From playing basketball. And I'm like, what the fuck are you guys doing playing... Whoa.
Ayo.
And wait a minute. Okay, so I'm at the point now where they're walking slowly, and I'm, walking behind them so I can catch the conversation, and... You can tell that the employee at the store is automatically going to that place that we all go to when somebody asks a really stupid question, a very bizarre question, not a stupid question, is this a joke? Because that's definitely what he's thinking.
Oh, yeah.
And the guy goes, I don't know what happened, but I've been playing a lot of basketball. I got this rash, and it's right here. And he grabs his groin area and kind of rubs a little bit and goes, and it just itches. And the guy's just, he's still not sure whether or not to take it seriously or not, but he goes, well, what you're going to want to, is an SPF? He goes, no, man, it's not a sunburn. It's like the itches. I got itches. He goes, well, it's probably from sweat and, causing some patches of dry skin over there. And I, whoa.
Oh.
TMI, man. Just TMI.
He's just trying to help.
Well, and then the guy goes, okay, well, what would get rid of that? And I guess in an attempt to sort of narrow down what lotions might work for this particular gentleman. He then asks him, he says, does it have an odor? And the guy goes, I don't care if the lotions smell or not. I just got to get rid of the itches. whoa. Okay, I know what he's talking about.
Clearly, that's not asking, but
no,
okay.
And he goes, no. He goes, well, does the rash, is it emitting an odor? And he goes, I can't get down there to smell it.
Oh, shit.
And I'm like, okay, I got to get away from you guys because I'm going to throw up. I just ate.
No, but that at that point, you need to follow along a little more, too.
No, you're already
into it, man. You got to keep going.
No, it was just weird. I don't know. I have a huge issue with coming up to people and going, hey.
So you just stopped? You just stopped following at that point?
Once you, it's bad. Okay, so you've got a rash. You're talking about it publicly to pretty much anybody. Really loud, booming basketball guy voice. I mean, not a real bright guy, but nonetheless, you could just tell. Total mouth breather, and I don't think he was sick like I am. But to just walk up randomly to an employee at a store and start describing your symptoms of your, what is obviously jock itch of some sort, it's just a little weird.
Oh, I would have to disagree with you. I really, really would. This guy is in agony. He's got this rash between his legs or on his groin, and he doesn't know what it is. Chances are it's probably just, heat rash or something that he needs to put some baby powder on. He doesn't necessarily need lotion. And by the way, he should probably call in an ointment or some moisturizer, not lotion. There's nothing. I mean, this guy is in dire need. Of course he's going to be able to talk. He wants to talk to anybody that's going to be willing to listen at that point.
Thank you, Dr. Miller.
I'm just saying. I'm your political and your medical expert today.
Wow, okay. Well, that works for me.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything wrong with this. I really hope the guy got it taken care of because that can't really be fun.
Well, it's embarrassing. What? It just is. It could be embarrassing. Should he potentially get into an intimate situation, or God forbid somebody from Vivid Video should call him up and say, hey, we want you to be in this Occupy movie, and well, you have that unsightly rash, you'll fit right in.
Aww.
You know what I mean? I mean, come on.
Bluge. It's gross.
It's awesome.
No, not really.
Yeah. Good times. Speaking of stupid people, if you ever needed a reason not to drink around your children, here's one. Dateline Kansas City, Missouri. The mother of a baby who went missing from her Kansas City home 2 weeks ago says, well, she was drunk when the girl disappeared.
Oh.
Deborah Bradley. Excuse me, I can't read. Told NBC's Today Show Monday that the night her baby, Lisa Irwin, disappeared, she had bought wine and had consumed enough to be drunk.
Uh-oh.
Bradley says police asked her if she killed Lisa, who was 10 months old when she disappeared October 4th. She says she doesn't think alcohol changes a person enough to do something like that. Obviously.
Oh, my goodness.
Obviously something of a boxed wine novice this one is.
Of course.
But she says that fearing arrest, she decided to come forward and let everybody know that for her part, she was indeed drunk at the time.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. She also says that because she was intoxicated, she may never know truly what happened.
Oh, that's terrible.
See, that right there, though, that is, it's a precedent-setting defense. I gotta take my hat off to Deborah Bradley of Kansas City, Missouri. Because back in the day, you would always just say, I was crazy, I was out of mind, I wasn't of sound mind when this happened. She's setting a precedent for I drank a whole box of wine. There's no way I could ever know.
I gotcha.
It's the boxed wine defense.
Okay.
Designed to get you out of any amount of trouble.
Uh-huh. Well, hopefully that boxed wine wasn't stolen from the Safeway. But she, I mean, you're basically saying because she came forward and said something. She was honest, basically.
Yes.
Right up front.
That's what you do now. You commit crimes like, you know, I don't know, say you were, you got tired of being harassed for $5 for pad thai on the street and smash someone's face. Well, you just simply say, you know, boxed wine defense. In my defense, I was so inebriated from boxed wine that no one will ever really know what happened.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody can just go, oh, okay. Well, you're off the hook.
Right.
You're off the hook.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's totally okay. I mean, she didn't... Who's to say if she actually really committed a crime? I mean...
No one will ever know.
Right.
You know, the only crime she probably committed was, you know, drinking cheaper wine. I mean, it's... You know, seriously, for many Americans, the ability to just get schnockered in your own home, in the privacy of your own home, I mean, that's gold. I mean, that's something we can't afford to lose.
Oh, yeah.
No matter what happens on Wall Street, no matter how many tech entrepreneurs may pass away in the next week, as Americans, we have that right to consume mass quantities of boxed wine and just kind of throw our hands up and go, I don't know. No one will ever know what happened. You know what I mean? That's a precious thing that each and every American should enjoy. A right, if you will.
Okay.
Yeah. Speaking of rights... Well, if you're a Ducks fan, you don't have the right to yell in Chip Kelly's ear. During a live post-game interview with ESPN's Erin Andrews Saturday night. Incidentally, ESPN's Erin Andrews, I don't like saying her name because I think she's a blithering idiot.
Oh, it's a girl. Okay.
Yes. And now I am all for female, the interviewer type people for sports and stuff like that. I always think, because the opposite of they always have the on-the-field person.
Mm-hmm.
And I like them to be female. I really do. Okay. I think that's awesome. I think it adds some diversity to, you know, what is normally a male-dominated type broadcast. And the other reason, of course, is there's that one fellow that I believe is with one of the big networks. You know who I'm talking about. Who?
It's like Tony V, I think is what they call him. I think he's with Fox.
No, Tony S.
Tony S.
Yeah, he's a big man, former NFL player. I can't stand that guy.
No.
Yeah, he's just had one sandwich too many. But anyway, during a live post-game interview with ESPN's Erin Andrews Saturday night, Oregon head coach Chip Kelly barked at a group of fans yelling behind them, "Hey, will you shut up?" You know how I know this?
How do you know this?
Because I have the audio from it right here.
Oh, very nice.
I'm so fancy. Stolen directly from ESPN.com, mind you.
Cool.
Well, a big play by your defense there in the end, but the big question all week long will be about your quarterback, your offense. What do you know about Darren Thomas's injury?
He gets injured in a game. Hey, will you shut up?
Thank you.
So don't cheer for a Ducks victory around Chip Kelly.
Oh, yeah.
He wants no part of it.
He doesn't want to have anything to do with it. He doesn't really care. He's just there to get his FaceTime with Erin Kelly or with
Erin Andrews.
Andrew, whatever.
Are you suggesting they should tie the knot then or what?
No.
Hey, Sabrina.
Hey, will you shut up?
Sorry.
I'm just kidding.
Okay. Yeah, this guy's a piece of work. I don't think I've ever really heard anything good about Chip Kelly, honestly.
Really?
Yeah, and I'm not a college football person by any means. I think it's kind of dumb, actually, but that's just me.
You think college football is dumb?
I mean, that's just me personally.
Giving young men excellence for which to strive is dumb.
I'm saying for everybody that likes it, it's fine. I don't quite understand it because...
Hey, will you shut up?
Okay, fine. Oh.
No, really, go on.
I just don't really understand it, but...
Hey, will you shut up?
God damn it!
What?
I've never heard anything good about Chip Kelly.
What's good to hear?
I don't know.
He's
That's
a college football
it.
Coach. What do you want? You want to hear that he what?
Oh, I just
gives money to the homeless and buys everybody pad thai. What?
Here's $5 for everybody. Now will you shut up?
He walks along the streets of Portland just handing out $5 bills.
Oh, that would be kind of cool.
Yeah, giving bus money out to kids that need to go to Eugene.
Exactly.
You know, what is he supposed to do?
I don't know.
He coaches a football team. You know, they tend to win.
Yeah.
What more do you want out of him?
I don't know.
What good does he need to be doing you? He's doing his job. He does his job fairly well, from what I hear.
I guess I hear that too. I've heard that he's kind of not a very nice person.
What, how nice do you want him to be?
I'm just saying. Maybe
why?
Like
why does everybody have to be nice?
Of like a good job, Ducks. You did good. Instead of like you know, I just.
Hey, will you shut up?
Instead of that, what do you want him to do? Give them all candy and roses or what?
Yeah, just adequate pats on the asses and send them on their way home.
Yeah, that always works.
Mm-hmm.
Colorado officials. Well, you're from Colorado.
Yep.
Have disqualified the grand champion goat from this year's state fair because they said it tested positive for an unapproved drug. The Pueblo Chieftain. Apparently is the name of a newspaper. But they reported Friday that a second goat entered by another child from the same family was also disqualified for the same drug. A representative says that the family got a letter from the Attorney General's office saying that her family's goats tested positive for a feed additive approved for swine, but not goats. She suspects the food may have been tampered with and says the family reported their suspicions to officials. And the family will appeal.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Disqualification means her son and daughter can't collect their earnings from the sale of the goats. $5,500 for the champion and $1,300 for the second goat.
Damn.
Yeah, that's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money for a goat.
God, I wish I had problems like that.
I wish I did, too. I mean,
I need to move to America's heartland and just raise stuff.
No,
cattle.
No. Where did you
whatever.
Say this was taking place?
Pueblo, Colorado.
Okay, I just wanted to hear you say it again.
Why?
Because you're mispronouncing it.
It's Pueblo.
It's Pueblo.
I know it is.
Okay.
But I like saying Pueblo.
Okay. I was like, are you being seriously right now?
No, you motherfuckers come up to the Pacific Northwest and mispronounce fucking everything. I'm going to say Pueblo fucking Colorado.
Colorado.
Colorado. Colorado. I don't even remember how I used to say it.
I don't know how you used to say it.
No, if you're from the Northwest, you know it as Colorado, the state in which Mark and Mindy was shot.
Oh, yes. That's or like supposedly all took place. For. Okay.
No, you know, pretty much when it comes right down to it. John Elway, Mork and Mindy. That's really about it.
All right.
I only know of Boulder, Colorado's existence because of Mork and Mindy. Otherwise, why go there?
You know, that's a very good question.
Yeah. So Pueblo. What'd you say it?
It's Pueblo.
Pueblo.
Yeah.
Pueblo.
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 Hooked on phonics works for us.
Yeah. There's that.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyway, I want to move to a podunk place like that. And is it, what kind of area is fuck it. What kind of area is this?
It's kind of like how it's described, honestly. I mean, it's a little bit more
of a... It's a goat-raising area.
It's a little bit more of a farm country, yeah. Mm. But there's, you know, I mean, people live there. It's not just like, hey, here's a farm with a house and like 20 miles
people
later,
live
you know?
In tents in downtown Portland, man. Nothing surprises me at this point.
This is true. The thing that I find funny about this is that, you know what? It's probably not the owner's fault. It's not like the son or the daughter, I mean, whoever sold these goats, it's probably not their fault. The goat probably ran over into the swine pen and started eating their feed. So ultimately, it's probably the goat's fault. He drugged himself. That's what I'm guessing.
The goat drugged himself.
I'm just saying. I mean,
fuck
okay.
this. No, I won't want to win. So you're basically saying that he's Lance Armstrong, the goat.
I
only
think
in
that he
form.
Sabotaged his winning, or I think he sabotaged himself. Like he didn't want to leave.
You're bothering me from not being able to say Pueblo, Pueblo, and you can't fucking say sabotage. What did you say first?
I was just getting my words mixed up. I can say sabotage just fine.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
This is going to come as a shock to you. So if you're standing right now, which I know you're not, go ahead and sit down. ABC, the television network, not the band, says its revamped version of the 1970s hit Charlie's Angels is being shut down after only 4 airings because of low ratings. The network said Friday that 4 more episodes remain to be aired. That's for a total of 8, because let's face it, if you're watching the Charlie's Angels TV series, 4+4 may be a stretch for you. The action series focused on 3 female detectives in Miami. The reboot has struggled in the ratings since its premiere last month. It's ABC's first cancellation of the new fall season.
Wow.
Yeah. The original Charlie's Angels, of course, aired for 6 full seasons on ABC and launched one of the angels, Farrah Fawcett, as a major star. More recently, 2 feature films were also produced, starring Cameron Diaz. And those other 2 people.
Drew Barrymore and Lucy Liu.
Yeah, them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. You know, honestly, this does not come as a surprise to me. And I really, really, really wish that Hollywood or ABC or like the TV manufacturing show people would get their heads out of their asses and realize that you cannot remake a show and it's just not going to be successful.
So to recap, Sabrina Miller today is the jock itch expert, the political expert, and the fall season TV show stupidity reboot expert.
I am your expert on anything today.
Really?
Sure, why not? I mean, you're sick and...
Well, I am sick, and I apologize.
That's okay.
You like coffee, right?
Yes, I do.
Well, coffee lovers the world over are facing a potential jolt. Starbucks is warning of a serious threat to the world coffee supply.
Uh-oh.
Yes, due to climate change, the caffeinated beverage loved by millions is on the verge of extinction, according to news reports. Jim Hanna, the company's sustainability director, said its farmers are already seeing the effects of a changing climate, with severe hurricanes and more resistant bugs, reducing crop yields.
Oh, man.
The company is now preparing for the possibility of a serious threat to global supplies. He said, quote, what we are really seeing as a company as we look 10, 20, 30 years down the road. Look at that. He can count it to 30 by tens. If conditions continue as they are, is a potentially significant risk to our supply chain.
Wow.
Now, the news, of course, is not going down well among coffee aficionados. Quote, I wouldn't want to live in a world without coffee, to be honest with you, says coffee lover T.J. Nolan. Adds coffee drinker Tim Root. Quote, this is probably my fourth cup of coffee today. I'd be pretty miserable. The Union of Concerned Scientists.
What?
It's a thing. It truly is.
Seriously?
Yes. It's one of the, see, I love it when organizations just have a name that says what they are. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The Union of Concerned Scientists is raising a similar alarm about a world without coffee in TV ads and testimony before Congress, who is, you know, turning a deaf ear to the entire thing. The group is warning that heavy rain, long droughts, and insect infestations linked to global climate change threaten the future of America's morning cup of joe. In barista speak, that means no venti, no grande, no nothing, not even a tall.
Oh.
So Starbucks may hedge its own beverage bets, investing in a chain of smoothie and juice bars.
Oh, come on.
Once coffee's gone, what are you going to do? You're going to have to go for the Folgers. The Folgers crystals, which isn't really coffee at all.
You know what? It's better than nothing.
It's not the same. There are a lot of calories compared to coffee, you know, in juice bars and smoothies. And there's more bad news. Another report out this week warned the future also may be bitter for chocolate. See what happened there?
Oh, yes.
Global warming could make parts of Africa too hot to grow the cocoa.
Oh, man.
Yeah. So far, Congress hasn't acted on the warnings. Quite content to sit back and, you know, stow lots and lots of money in its own coffers. Because they are, in fact, part of the 1%.
Oh, my gosh. What are they going to do anyway? I mean, it's Congress. What are they going to say? Oh, global warming. You must stop now so that we can have our chocolate and our coffee. They're not going to be able to do anything about it. It's a natural thing. It's just going to kind of happen. I mean, it sucks.
Now, Ashley in the chat box says, so the cocaine market is also in trouble. Yes, and that right there is what you're going to get. If Congress is going to act, that's where they're going to be looking. Right there. They're going to go, now, wait a minute. Cocoa, who cares? You know, you're talking about guys that dress in suits every day and really just live a soulless, baseless existence, you know, entirely just for the fun and thrill of gaining more and more profits. They don't have to worry about, you know, maybe, because, you know, the old adage is that women really like chocolate.
It's good for your health.
Congress hates women. So, you know, let's just throw that out there.
Okay.
Congress, United States government just hates women. They always have. You know, they let a certain amount of men, you know, to come and play so that we don't bitch. Same thing they do with, you know, yeah, we'll let a couple of black people in. We'll let a couple of Mexicans in. But ultimately, Congress hates anybody that's not an old white guy. It's true.
Wow.
It's true.
Okay.
You don't believe me?
Robert Wagner, your political expert.
I was kind of hoping you'd take the lead on that, but you didn't. So.
No, I didn't really know that. I just kind of thought, hey, yay, I'm naive, and we're all created and taken seriously equal or something. I don't know. This is dumb. I mean, if you've ever bought coffee, especially recently, like the prices on that stuff it's already, I think, really kind of ridiculous. And honestly, I'd much rather buy a thing of Folgers for like,
you mean, a container?
Yeah, a container because, well, it's like more value, but it's getting expensive and it's only going to go up, so.
This is true. See, y'all should have sat down, shut the fuck up, and listened to Al Gore.
Yeah.
That's really what it comes down to. Al Gore was right. And I'm only ever going to say that once. Well, I'll say it one more time just for effect. Al Gore was right. There, I'm done.
Okay.
Yeah.
How is he right?
You're the political expert in the room, the self-proclaimed political expert in the room, and you have no idea about the connection between Al Gore and climate change, do you?
I do.
You don't, do you?
Okay, I'm sorry.
Global warming and Al Gore, these two things aren't... They
make sense, yes. I just
they make sense?
Them. They go together. I mean, it's like peanut butter and chocolate? Jelly.
Oh, peanut butter jelly.
Yeah, that too. Well, the peanut butter is going to be extinct here soon too.
Why?
Because, I mean, it's the same problem that they're having with the chocolate and with the coffee beans, that the climate change is like
killing
screwed
the
up
peanuts?
All the, yeah, it's like screwing up all the peanut crops.
Okay, well, I'm here to tell you, you know what's fucking up the peanut crops? You know why there is a world shortage of peanut crops?
Why?
Because of Five Guys motherfucking burger and fries. That's why. Because those motherfuckers, they put like goddamn big old boxes of goddamn peanuts out. So that when your sorry white ass goes through the door, you go, oh, look, free peanuts. I can sit here for half an hour and gorge myself on peanuts. Just throw the shells on the floor. There is the rent in Washington Five Guys Burger and Fries. There's so many peanut shells on the floor, they are pouring out from under the door, out onto the sidewalk in front of the establishment.
Aww.
So you telling me there's a peanut shortage? If Five Guys Burger and Fries is at the root of that shortage.
Okay, well then, aside from the Five Guys Burgers and Fries, there's also like places, I can't remember, Lone Star Steakhouse. I mean, like steakhouses all
is
over
that
America.
Pueblo?
No, it's
Pueblo? Pueblo?
They're in Colorado. I don't know if they're anywhere else, but I'm just saying. They're kind of good steaks there, but yeah, there's like peanuts all over the floor there, and it's really annoying, and you just always think that you're stepping on something, which technically you are. It's just really distracting.
It's distracting.
Oh yeah,
there's like bugs.
Yeah,
you turn the lights out, it's just crunchy crunchy crunchy, kind of like that Indiana Jones film.
Well, and then you
have
to,
that crunching sound.
Oh,
that's your brain, but don't worry, the director will eventually marry you.
Right. Then you're tracking this shit everywhere, back into your car and at home, and you know, it's just I'm just saying, really, things like peanut butter or peanuts, coffee, and chocolate, people, don't waste it. Go and hoard them now, just like your plastic bags if you live in the city of Portland. And, you know, just start buying the crap up and just hoarding it.
I have a question for somebody on the chat box. Okay, and this is, we're going back. Okay, we're going back. Okay, see what I'm,
yes.
We're taking present and going back.
Okay.
Broken Cello in the chat box. I assume is from the Seattle area. And pardon me, sometimes I have a hard time remembering who's from where and things like that, but is sharing a little bit of a story here.
Okay.
About occupying Seattle.
Oh, great.
And I haven't been following Occupy Seattle. I really haven't. Mm-hmm. It's taken every fiber of my being not to, but with so much going on here, it's difficult for me to look beyond the walls of Portland right now.
Of course.
Because our 99% is quasi-ridiculous. But Broken Cello says, hey, Rob, I just wanted to say, I read your blog post about the funk you could cut with a knife down at Occupy Portland. The same is sadly true in Westlake Park. I was in downtown Seattle yesterday with a miss having a cup of coffee. Well, don't think you'll be doing that for very long. And the homeless funk was so intense, it burned the back of my throat. Now I cannot unremember that smell.
Oh, God.
If you have no idea what I'm talking about, go to robwagpdx.com. Don't leave this window to do so, though. You can actually read and listen at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, Westlake Park. Where is Westlake Park? See, I used to work on Westlake Avenue.
Okay.
Which is down at the south end of Lake Union, which to me, it would seem almost to be pointless. Now, if I go back, you know, a decade or something like that, mm-hmm. For anybody to be protesting around Westlake whatsoever. Now, they've changed that area.
That's what I thought. Then they, from what I understand, at one point they had removed, businesses. They put in the sidewalk and put in, another, more of, a walking community or some weird thing.
Oh, it's fucking hell.
I can't remember. I don't remember exactly
what
they did.
Oh, okay. It's not. It's not where I'm thinking it is.
Okay.
Yeah, Westlake Park is by Westlake Center.
Okay.
Me.
Well, that's where my brain went the first time, Westlake Park, that it was around the center there, but...
Yeah.
I still can't really picture where...
It's by Westlake Center.
Picture
in your mind Westlake Center.
I figured as much. I just didn't know there was a park.
See,
there.
People from Colorado go to Seattle and they go, what's this Weeslocky? Oh, I'm heading down to Weeslocky
Park.
Okay,
we're not that dumb, okay?
Yeah, you are.
We may drug our goats or whatever, but we're not that dumb.
Yeah, Westlake Park. Oops. My bad. I was thinking of Westlake, because you remember Westlake Avenue?
Yeah, yeah.
All the goddamn development started happening down there. It used to be a place where, blue-collar guys... Not unlike myself, would go down to do blue-collar jobs, not unlike the job I used to have. And we'd work for 10 hours straight and get all manner of dirty and smelly and actually do hard labor. They changed it into a great place for condos and people with little puppies that they could walk around and go get espressos.
Oh, my goodness.
It's a wonderful little area. Yeah, the average rate for a condo down there, I believe, is $2.2
million.
Wow. $2.2 million.
Oh, my God.
$2.2 million gets you a one-bedroom, 670-square-foot, somewhere in there, condominium on Westlake Avenue. Now, this is an area that just a decade ago was like a hub of industry, mostly in the marine area. But, hub of industry. It was where all the blue-collar jobs in the marine industry took place.
Oh.
You know what happened to those jobs? Gone.
Oh, shit.
Gone. They are now the, they're not even the 99%. They're like the 0% because those jobs are gone.
They're gone.
Don't exist anymore.
Right.
And so, that's.
Huh.
Adapt
Holy
or
crap.
Die.
Wow. I bet they have their people are riding their fancy little mopeds and stuff around there too. I mean, God.
In Seattle?
Yeah.
Nah, not a big moped place anymore.
Really?
Nah, not really.
Oh.
Now, you get like a $7,000 bicycle is what you do.
See, that's so sad though. I mean, $2.2 million for a con. How many of those are actually occupied?
About two-thirds, I think.
That's just...
This is sell-through because they really developed it, I mean, before the housing shit, you know, the real estate thing went tanked. You know, okay. What I mean? And, you know, they're still doing it. It's still being developed. But, yeah, I don't even recognize that area. I mean, that area was the same way for, like, 50 years. Not that I remember that far back, of course, but as I understand it. You used to go to these quaint little diners, and there'd be all these pictures, like old black and white photos of what the area used to look, and it'd be like, it looks the same, you know, back when I was there.
Yeah.
Anymore, you don't even recognize it.
I see a lot of that around Portland here, too, which I think is kind of cool. I'll sit there and stare at it and figure out where that's actually at the current moment.
What?
What? You don't have your hand on the sound button to tell me to shut up.
I'm over here.
Okay.
I'm mobile today.
Ah. No, I think some of those things are kind of cool. I mean...
$2.2 million condominiums are cool. Thank you, Sabrina Miller.
No. Looking at the old-timey kind of photographs and seeing how things used to be.
Yeah. Well... It's only recently that we've really just been absolutely decimating our own heritage.
Mm-hmm.
And I support this.
Really?
No.
I didn't think so.
Because look what happens. You end up losing things like coffee.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, and I feel really bad for the... I'm sorry, I don't remember his name in the chat box that just read you that story.
Broken Cello.
I feel sorry for him because, I mean, he's sitting there, like, you know, with his lady drinking coffee, and he's smelling this poop that's, like, everywhere. That's going to be the last thing he remembers as far as, like, his coffee goes. I mean, you know what, dude? Guzzle it up right now. Just, you know, take this whole week in case coffee is gone next week and just guzzle it up. But just...
Well, the interesting thing...
It's tainted now.
The interesting thing is the amount of the Occupy people I've seen walking around with respirators on
yeah.
is phenomenal. And when you actually stop and think about it, it makes perfect sense. They don't have to smell themselves.
Yeah.
You know, they've got the little cartridges that they put in the little respirator mask, and they just walk around. We are the 99%. You know, because most of America has a respirator.
Right. Or they'll have, like, the little bandana handkerchief things that probably, I mean, it's a piece of cloth. It's not really going to filter out too much, you know, of your stink at that point. I mean, you know.
No. The handkerchief, I think, is to disguise you in case all of a sudden shit goes down and you have to perform the anarchy.
Right.
You know?
What? I'm sorry.
I actually saw a guy the other day that had a sign, and I can't remember exactly what it was, but he had spelled anarchy A-N-A-R-C-Y.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. That's bad.
You are the 99%. You know, the functionally illiterate 99%.
Exactly. Now, that's really bad, especially because I also read the other blog post that you did with the Mercedes sign.
I was corrected about that. That was not the peace symbol. Yeah.
Oh, it was supposed to like literally like be the Mercedes symbol?
No. Okay, so I had taken a picture from down there.
Yeah.
Just as a backstory for those who don't follow the blog. And you shouldn't because it's worthless. I mean, it's frivolity at its finest. I mean, I put like a half-assed movie review up there today. But, and we'll get to that in a minute because, you know, let's face it. I'm running out of gas. Steam, gas. I don't know. Whatever. Coffee. Yeah, I took a picture and I didn't look at the ground after I took it. I wasn't actually taking a picture of, oh, there it is. So I took a picture on Saturday of the Occupy people when they were in, Pioneer Courthouse Square, and on the ground was what looked like a peace symbol greater than and a dollar sign.
Okay.
And so I kind of put it out on the internet after it was pointed out to me because I was actually taking a picture of the fact that the masses were advancing to where I was sitting. And I needed to move right then. You know, it was kind of like, you know, like zombies.
Mm-hmm.
You're like, here they come.
I've had that feeling too.
We want your brains.
Blood.
Brains. Blood. A plate of pad thai. And somebody on Twitter actually pointed out, wait a minute, why is Mercedes greater than dollar sign?
Yeah.
You know, and I'm like, I'm looking, what? Oh, wow. And so then I thought, well, it must be a peace symbol. And, you know, one of these hippies just totally failed miserably. I was actually corrected today after, I probably had like 40 emails. Nobody said a damn word about this. So this is obviously a symbol that has not caught on.
Oh, okay.
I've had about 40 emails, hate emails, mind you.
Oh, no.
That are just very anti-me, saying that, you know, I'm spreading this propaganda.
Oh, God.
Obviously, I don't understand the movement, which I do. That's the whole thing. I actually do. I mean, I can relate to the fact that, you know, yes, we should hang a whole bunch of people that ran banks for a while. I'm fine with this. Just get rid of them. Put them in a meat grinder. I don't give a shit. Make them into dog food. But anyway, somebody actually replied and said, it's not intended as a peace symbol. You're looking at it upside down, which, no shit. It's a circle Y, which symbolizes humanity. What kind of dumb motherfuckers?
What?
It's a circle Y, which represents humanity. That's the symbol. This is the new symbol for humanity is a circle Y. It's like three wedges of a pie put together. And I don't know why this... It's the Mercedes logo, you fucktard.
No kidding.
Why would you take... Because when I think Mercedes-Benz, I think humanity. No, I don't. I think assholes that, you know, spend money in really stupid places.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What?
You're looking at it through your boomer eyes, as though I'm a baby boomer. It was
come
weird.
Come on.
Yes, because you're so enlightened that you dumb kids have put together a symbol now. Get off my lawn. But seriously, why would you use the Mercedes symbol, upside down, right side up, it doesn't matter, as the symbol for humanity? I don't understand that.
They probably don't know that it's the Mercedes symbol.
Of course they don't, because they don't have any fucking money, because they're the goddamn 99%.
Wow. Are like the youth of today are like making up symbol. I mean, I guess, you know, hey, we'd make up symbols too for our generation or whatever, but that's just dumb.
Yeah.
I mean, how are we supposed to know? You didn't put a disclaimer on it. You didn't put a little caption underneath it.
No.
You know, I mean, I've seen some of the protesters, and they're older too. Are they going to know what this thing means too?
If your symbolism is not symbolic to the very people you're trying to get a message across to, then your symbolism doesn't work.
No.
At all. All these people are thinking, anybody that sees this photo at this point, well, they're going to look at it and they're going to go, either you're too retarded to make a full peace symbol, or you can't afford a Mercedes. It's one or the other. Nobody's going to look at this and go, oh, that's obviously the circle Y, the symbol for humanity. Oh, go fuck yourself. Really? You know, no. It's just not. I'm sorry nobody buys shit from your stupid Etsy store, you asshat. But nonetheless, nobody cares about this. Nobody's ever heard of this.
Yeah.
You know, one person, after as many emails as I've had, nobody corrected me once. It was one person out of that many people actually knew what this was.
Huh.
No, clearly that's the circle Y, the symbol for humanity. Why wouldn't the symbol for humanity be a circle around a Y?
Yeah, that's just dumb.
It doesn't even make any sense to me.
And for as much as you were retweeted, and I even put it out there, and as much as I was retweeted and had conversations with people, you know, on Twitter about it, people were like, oh, no, it's clearly, you know, it's just upside down. People kept saying it's just upside down.
When you said it was a peace symbol.
Yeah.
Yes, but that's because the average person does not know what a damn peace symbol looks like anymore.
Right.
That's how badly we fail.
Wow.
And, you know, here again. Just as a final disclaimer, it's not that I don't get the whole movement. It's that you guys have no obvious mission at all. The best moment of my year so far, though, has to do with this image. The best moment of my year so far.
Yeah?
Yeah. Despite all the great news that's happened in my life, the absolute, okay, second best moment of my life, of my year this far, can be summed up by the fact that this picture that I took with my shitty little phone at stupid little Pioneer Square around the stupid protesters that were obviously advancing to come and eat my pad thai, was it that this picture was featured on my new blog mentor's blog. A blog so famous, so righteous, so bold, so amazing that only one man is fit to be my mentor. That's right. I'm actually bowing down to the almighty Jack Bodansky. Bojack.org. You want to check it out. My picture made it on Bojack.org.
Wow.
Yeah. And you know what it said?
What?
Underneath it, to give me credit, it just said, via Wagner. A little link to my site.
Oh, that's so awesome.
It's awesome.
That sounds incredibly righteous.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, I've been around Portland long enough to know that, you know, hey, if you're going to make some change, you got to stand up for your shit. You know what I mean? You got to get up there and you got to just tell it like it is. You know what I mean? You got to just not be worried about what people are going to think. You just got to throw it out there like, you know what I mean? Just get it out there. And only one man today that I know of actively blogging in the Portland area without any affiliation to any sort of media outlets or payola or any of that garbage whatsoever, Bojack.org. I don't always agree with him, but by God, if he's a force to reckon with. I now base all of my, teach me, man. Teach me. For I cannot teach myself any more than I've already taught. And I need, my quest for knowledge, my thirst for it is so great that I enjoy drinking from your fountain.
Is this the fountain of like chocolate and coffee or something?
No, he's white.
That's not what I meant. Why would you go there?
I didn't go there. You went there. Why is it the fountain of chocolate and coffee?
Because that's what we've been talking. What up, player?
Bojack.org.